Thank you, Lisa, being here with us. I'm very happy to talk with you, to have a conversation for this great project, Archaeology at Home. Could you please briefly describe the Archaeology at Home project?
Yes, Archaeology at Home was our instant response to the conditions of the global pandemic. We work with the public quite a lot doing archaeology. And of course, with the lockdowns, not only could we not go out into the field, but also everybody else was at home. And so that dramatically affected our ability to actually do our work. And we looked at all of the content and all of the materials. We have online courses. We had all of this content to share. And we thought, well, if we can't be in the field digging with people, what can we do to continue to keep archaeology in front of their eyes and operate as a team? And so we launched the project, and it was three distinct streams of activity. It's funny almost to think of now because we're so advanced in our practice online, but try to remember if you can what it was like when the pandemic first started. You know, it was very different. We weren't as sophisticated as participants or consumers around digital activities. So we just thought, let's just do it. And it consisted of, you know, very lighthearted events like pub quizzes, archaeology quizzes, virtual site tours, you know, just a way for our team to keep together and in practice. And little by little, it started to grow. And then we have an online course called How to Do Archaeology, which is 6 chapters, and it takes people through the actual process, demystifying how do we actually choose a site? How do you dig a site? What's that tool for? What do you do after? What if you find something? And so we released that and thought, oh, you know, maybe we'll have a handful of people who maybe want to do this with us while they're stuck at home. And we got completely overwhelmed. We had over 8,000 people in 91 countries all at once together to do archaeology. And actually, this was one of the aspects that really fascinated the judges, which, you know, perhaps we can talk a little bit more about later. And then we followed that up. We were supposed to also do a big festival that summer, all archaeology, a whole weekend. And we had to put that online as well. And we welcomed another almost 4,000 people to that as well. So all of that together was archaeology at home. It kept us going. And it was really good fun.
That's it. Really impressive. Really impressive. Those numbers are just huge. And knowing what happened during this pandemic and everything upside down and considering organizing things this way and having distraction, I would say, audience is just a great and impressive project. Maybe some words about how was this award-winning project conceived, but the rationale, the objectives, the aims of the project.
Sure. The rationale and objectives of this project of archaeology at home really came just from this instant response of wanting to give back, of knowing that we as professionals were stuck at home, away from our labs and away from our field work. But equally, so was a world full of people. And when you do archaeology, you know that deep inside everyone is this tiny fascination for archaeology, even if they don't think so. But wherever you go, people always want to say, oh, have you heard about the mummy? Everyone's got a story, or, you know, Indiana Jones. And so we knew that out there were people who, you know, were probably going to be at home and scared and of the whole world situation, as we were as well. So the rationale for it was, let's give something back in this moment of, you know, world stoppage for our own selves, but for other people as well. And because we were already digital, and we had some content, and we had a methodology for working with audiences, the idea was that rather than inventing new things, rather than having to create new things, let's curate the things we already have and give them another life, like remobilize them in a way. And so that's where it started. And as you say, the numbers are unbelievable. We have never matched it in terms of that moment since, because of course everyone's back to work. But in the moment, it really took us by surprise as well. And we had results from the project that we couldn't possibly have anticipated.
Definitely something really interesting, really important to have this give giving life to, in fact, giving a second life, I would say, to objects, to all the point of interest, all these themes and topics during this COVID. You said Indiana Jones. Of course, it resonates with everybody, I think.
Yes.
Those facts and playing with while being at home, definitely is really interesting how you put this together. Maybe some words about what was the particular quality or innovation impressing the Heritage in Motion Award jury.
Yes. Well, Heritage in Motion is obviously about new technology and new methodologies in terms of using tech, because it isn't just the digital elements itself, but it's the workflow, right, that you design around it that makes it an innovation. And that for us was the motion part of the Heritage in Motion. And in terms of the feedback we've had from judges, obviously the numbers of people very much impressed them as us. And, I think folded within that was because there were so many people from so many countries, it was the internationality of it, and which enabled obviously by tech and by the workflows that we had built around that. So rather than just opening our Zoom and starting in with something, we realized you have to set this up as an experience for people in the same way you would set it up if they're coming to see you inside or they're coming to see you in a museum. What is the visitor experience of that? So that was very crucial, I think, in terms of the feedback we received, that was an innovative quality that the Heritage in Motion judges responded to. And within that was the diversity. So you have a huge audience like this, and then just by virtue of that, there are a lot of people who wouldn't normally be sitting at home in the middle of the week with time on their hands. They'd be at work or they'd be doing other things. And so that meant we had a big diversity in terms of our demographics, very unusually kinds of people. And the big statistic that the judges liked was that 80% of the people who joined us for Archaeology at Home, this was their first ever encounter with Archaeology. So this is 80% of minds that, you know, we got to colonize with our Archaeology, which I loved. Some of them have stayed with us. And again, it was also accessibility, using the tech accessibly and taking people through an experience rather than just hitting them with a wall of information. You must learn now. You must enjoy now. You will only experience this in one way. We very much left it open and had a spectrum. So you could do a little bit. You could do a lot. You could come sometimes. You could give us some money if you wanted or not. So that's what the judges shared.
Yeah, it is really interesting to have this feedback, and it makes a huge sense on this very particular times where everybody had time, and play with things was, you know, the thing to find out how to move, how to take this time and do things and discover and experiment. 80% is just awesome. Definitely.
Yes. I know. And it reminds me of the things that I had the time to experience then, now that I'm back to working life, that I don't have so much room anymore. And I kind of, you know, could use more space, let's say, for more innovation.
Yeah, definitely. So starting with that, what were the, I would say, the difficulties or positive experiences you had during this project's realization?
The difficulties were around capacity and within my team, because we had a furloughing scheme in the UK. So it was very hard with the amount of team, limited number of team that were still working, to respond to the huge numbers of people that started to join us, because all this was happening across Facebook and our social channels. That takes a lot of time to plan and deal with. So we had, you know, those difficulties, but also, you know, people were, the world, everyone was coping, let's say, with at different levels of ability. So because it was social media, they were bringing social media behaviors to our events as well. So you would have people coming to an Archaeology event, but then the discussion would turn to things completely non-archaeological, you know, people losing their jobs, people being diagnosed with COVID, other serious diagnoses, losing loved ones. And, you know, so it was challenging as an archaeologist to all of a sudden realize that the social side of social media behaviors, which was all we had right then for connecting, was becoming so much more important sometimes than the content that we were sharing. And this is a whole different set of skills, and not every archaeologist necessarily has this training, you know. And I think the benefits, as I said just before, we had so much space because everything, the whole world slowed down. So these normal demands on your time when you have an idea and you maybe want to follow the idea and you can feel something creative at the end of it, but you have a meeting or the phone rings or the dog needs to go out or the kids need to get picked up, or then all of a sudden you lose that room. And because the rest of the world was so much slower, we had all this space around the sides to be like, where can this creativity take the process of archaeology at home? And I don't think I would have ever been brave enough to turn a festival that I was planning to have at a castle online if we hadn't been like, well, it worked with the course, let's do it with the conference as well. And so the project was very positively impacted by that.
Yeah, definitely. It sounds like it is like archaeology is the ground for a kind of psychologist or actions and the talks and experiments, because you this social thing on the ground, which is very solid, which is archaeology. It's really interesting to have this this balance between things, definitely.
Yes, what we discovered, I think, and one of my really lasting impressions from this is that people experience archaeology in the same way that they experience lots of other kinds of culture. So they have the same experience. It's undefinable that they have when they see a dance performance or feel moved by music or look at a painting, like you're feeling something and you're having this experience. And what we saw happen through archaeology at home was people having that same kind of emotion with archaeology. And many people don't think of archaeology in that way. They think of it as a science, or they think of it as something that's kind of very one-dimensional and not a conversation in that way as you have with other kinds of cultures. So we're still thinking about that.
Yeah, it's really, really, really interesting from that perspective. You just talked about three activities. Would you tell us a little bit more on which one had, I would say, the biggest impact on remote audiences and maybe why?
I think the biggest impact. Well, I think it's important to say there were two different audiences. So we have the general public audience, and then we had our audience of professional archaeological colleagues. So if you're talking about professionals, the one that had the biggest impact was the festival, which we called DigNation. Because for many of these people, so we had 26 countries represented, but 34 teams from 26 countries. And many of these teams had never presented their work outside of an academic context previously. So we put up a whole training program for them. How do you record yourself? What materials do you need? How do you set up your lights? You know, so presenting in that format and having fun with it was a coaching proposition for them. And also I did have feedback saying, I really enjoyed that. I'll do more talking maybe to the public now outside of an academic context. So I would say DigNation had the biggest impact on our professional colleagues who, you know, then got to see other people within our community of interest worldwide and find new projects to be a part of or make research connections. But in terms of the wider public, I would say definitely the course. This was the How to Do Archaeology, which we had a Facebook study group. We still do. The course still runs. And this had the highest participation, so over 8,000 people, plus a child's version. And we watched them. We watched ourselves become almost unnecessary because they would teach each other, and people who had done the course previously are still in the study group, and they would come in and say, oh, well, this is what you want to think about when you're trying to study that, and this is how archaeology works in my country, and this is a legislation that you need to think about if you're doing that thing, or, you know, so, and this emotional experience they were all having around a shared interest of archaeology. It started with the archaeology, but then it became much bigger. And we've heard of some of the participants now, for example, going on to take other online courses together from different countries. We found out that there were five groups of university students whose fieldwork had been canceled. And they, as a group, as a cohort, took the course together. So we know of one in Jamaica, Saudi Arabia, Malaysia, one in Scandinavia, and one in the States. So I'm really, really proud of that.
Yeah, thank you, Asim. And related to the topics of interest, do you have any tips, any information on which topic interests the audiences the most?
It's never possible to choose which kind of archaeology is going to get people most excited. But if I had to choose one, I would say undiscovered sites. Everybody wants to be the first to discover something or understand something. And through the course, actually, through one of the chapters of examining LIDAR and satellite images, we had a couple of new sites that were found. And this seemed to really like turn everybody, really turn them on. The little light bulbs over their heads went off. So I would say that, I guess, generally.
Yeah. It is, yeah, definitely. I think it is this idea of being the first one and moving and finding and exploring. It is our nature, I would say, as a human being, maybe.
And these are, you know, most of the people who joined us come from very developed countries, you know, developed enough to have an internet connection stable enough to take part in these things.
Yeah.
And the thought that there is still something unknown there, that there is still something to discover that hasn't been built over or found by somebody else is really exciting. You know, like it makes you think about the potential when you leave your house every day, like what's still there under the ground, you know, things were very different before, which might mean they can be different again. And it was, I think, that sense of almost freedom during a lockdown that was really, really powerful for people.
Related to the virtual field school program, I would love to learn it a little bit more about how it worked for young audiences, in fact.
Yes. Or, well, come and take the course. Come and take the course, Cyprian. So the way that it works, we have an adult's version called How to Do Archaeology. And across our sites here in the UK, we see a very high proportion of young learners who want to come and do archaeology. Kids love playing in the dirt. We started something called Dig Camp, where a parent and a child can come together and join us in our main trenches and dig together. And there really isn't a lot of provision in the UK for children to do archaeology, but yet it's such a fantastic way for them to get their first taste of science, and you can be outdoors and it's a really fun day out together and you learn. So we thought, why not develop the course into a child's version online as well? So this was another one of the things that we already had, the tools that we already had, because we'd made it for our audiences anyway. So it was really just a simplified version of the adults course to help the kids understand if they wanted during lockdown, you know, if they wanted to go out and dig a hole in the garden, or if they had found something in their garden, there were resources there, but equally talking a little bit about what it's like to be an archaeologist. So what we're trying to do is get them when they're young and, you know, turn a whole new generation of archaeologists into being. So the kids course is really just the same thing we teach the adults, but a little more active and with more thrown in about, you know, come and be an archaeologist.
Lisa, it was such a great moment having this conversation and learning more about how finally you managed to put this archaeology in the center of much more than just talking about the topic of archaeology, but building, making, I would say, connections, feelings, experiences for remote audiences. And those numbers are just impressive. I would like to thank you for your time and for sharing this with us, and definitely looking forward to see what your next experiences around maybe archaeology or something else.
Oh, well, stay tuned. And I have to thank, we really wanted to thank Europeana and the Heritage in Motion program, because this has opened up opportunities for us. And I think you'll be seeing us back in Europe really soon.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you. Awesome.
Excellent.
Have a great day. Thank you, Lisa.